Sorry, my computer's taking a second to pull up. While it does, Mr. Davis is present in custody. Standby counsel, Mr. Klaus is also present. Chief Deputy District Attorney Stacy Collins is present. I received an email yesterday, and I can make it a, I can make sure that everybody has a copy. It's from the psych nurse practitioner that saw Mr. Davis yesterday. And I'll make this as a exhibit. All right, so it states that Mr. Davis' appearance was appropriate, his speech was expressive, his mood was depressed and anxious, that he discussed that he previously had had some issues with post-traumatic stress disorder, that it's chronic, but he denies ever have been formally diagnosed with anything. That his affect was tearful, his thought form was coherent, that his thought content was appropriate, that he was oriented to person, place, purpose, and time, that his memory was intact, that his intelligence is average, that his insight is fair, judgment is fair, his behavior was appropriate. That he did admit that he was being emotional and got tearful during, and he did get tearful during the assessment, but that he was calm, lucid, and cooperative with the nurse practitioner. That he, and those were, and I'll, like I said, I'll make sure everybody has a copy of that. So, Mr. Davis, how are you feeling today, sir?
Your Honor, first off, I would like to issue you an apology for my behavior in your courtroom several times. It's not indicative of who I am. I was going through some serious pain with my ankle monitor, and it really, when I got angry and my anxiety going up and stuff, and that was really triggering a lot of my emotions. Also, I'd like to apologize to Mrs. Collins because she didn't deserve the things I said to her. Mrs. Collins, I respectfully, I respect you. I think you had some people that said some things in your ear that might have led you another way or something like that. But I'm not a bad person. I don't think you're racist. I don't think you're very DA. I think some people make statements to you. And you, I don't know, for whatever reason, you don't check them out and see. And then, you know.
First of all, I want to tell you that I do appreciate your apologies. And I think that.
And I'll be on my best behavior.
Okay. So just one thing that I want to tell you is trial is, you know, it's a really stressful environment. And I can tell you, having done almost 60 jury trials, that even as an attorney, it gets stressful and emotions get high, and so I understand that. I really do, and I'm compassionate to that, okay? I appreciate the sentiments that you have expressed this morning. I appreciate your professionalism in speaking with the nurse practitioner yesterday, who stated that you were calm, lucid, cooperative, that you had discussed some things that had happened in your past that you feel have kind of contributed to this, perhaps like a post-traumatic stress disorder type thing. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to take it slow, day by day. We're going to work through things. And when it starts to get stressful or overwhelming, then I just want you to take some deep breaths.
Yeah, Your Honor, I would like to talk to you and the DA and chambers, and maybe we can work something out so this don't have to go to trial. I don't want to put three juries that have been sexually assaulted through this.
Oh, they're not on the jury.
They're not.
What did you say? I apologize.
There's three females that were sexually assaulted, and they were.
Oh, the three females that you had talked about before. Oh, I'm sorry. I understand what you're saying. Oh, which brings me to where I need to make sure I understand. Say one more thing. One of the jurors that is on has become ill and has missed several days of work because of that. And I'll provide you with an email that he had sent saying, I've been sick for several days, I've missed work. And so I think we're probably in a situation where we're going to have to let him go, which would mean one of the alternate jurors. I think it's either Mr. Mays or Mr. I think it's Harden would then become a juror.
Yes, Your Honor. I'd rather try to work something out with the court before I go to trial and maybe get this over with so I don't have to sit in jail forever. And I mean, Your Honor, I had the understanding that I didn't violate my ankle monitor.
No, I need it, and that's so, where we're going to get that in a second. So I read your health assessment. I don't have any plans on keeping you in custody during this trial.
Right. Yes, Your Honor.
So, I appreciate that. My plan would be to take you, to release you back to the condition that you were previously in, which would be the house arrest bracelet. I would make sure that they worked with you so that there weren't any issues and so that you would remain out of custody during the trial.
Your Honor. That is very traumatic, that bracelet. I give you my word. I'm a former military. I have never had an FTA. I have nowhere to run. If I ran, the jury would find me guilty. They can have a trial without me, and I'd be found guilty. There's nowhere for me to run. I'm too recognizable. There's nowhere I can go. I never had an FTA. The ankle bracelet is so painful. You just don't understand. And it started buzzing and beeping.
Well, like I said, right now,
I got clear. I'm so clear-headed, and I'm so calm, and that putting it on me is like, it reminds me of like slavery or something, just throw something on your ankle, and boom.
I know, but I have to, without facts being presented to me that are different, then I have to return you to the situation we were in. So I'm happy to work with you in house arrest to make sure the bracelet isn't an issue, but If you prefer, I can't imagine you would prefer this, but if you prefer to remain in custody so you don't have to deal with that during the trial, I'm happy to do that.
What I won't mind doing is going to the police station every 6 hours, checking in. I won't mind getting up in the middle of the night to go check in.
No, we're not going to do that.
Your Honor, I don't mind doing that because the ankle bracelet is really, it really triggers me. Somehow that thing triggers me.
Well, then do you...
For 5 months, I've been triggered. You got to see my ankle. Look at my ankle. You gotta see this. If I take off my socks, it is so painful you wouldn't believe it. Look at the back of my foot, my heel. Look at that. And look at this, Your Honor. If I can crouch.
Yep.
Well, I can see it. Just show me.
Look at the back of my heel, and then look at this, the front of it, and then look at the side of it.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. I will have them work with you. But if you would want. I can't imagine you would want this, but would you prefer to stay in?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. All right, Ms. Collins, one thing that he has discussed is wishing to negotiate this matter with you. I remember that you had originally placed on the record an offer, and that offer had been rejected, and then it had been pulled off the table. As you stand here today, are there any offers on the table?
I am willing to discuss offers with him. Any offer I would discuss with him would obviously remainder on house arrest. I can't just let him go, but I'm willing to discuss an offer with him through Mr. Klaus and have that explained to him. I would like the court to make findings pursuant to Melcher that you don't have a reasonable doubt as to his competency and all of those.
Yeah, so that sure, I'm happy to do that. So competency was never the issue or was never the question. The issue was a mental evaluation because, as he stated on the record, he felt because of my rulings that I was driving him crazy or I was driving him to have a mental breakdown. I watched 2 days of voir dire where he very effectively issue-spotted the issues in his case, went and spoke with each juror appropriately. Not only did he ask appropriate questions, but they then responded. When they responded to him, he would then respond and engage in conversations and question answering with them. That was, I found, to be very effective. Where things started to kind of deteriorate is when he was frustrated with those individuals that were put on the jury and then his witness list. Like I said, there have never been any questions on his behalf or comments on his behalf or findings on my behalf that his actual competency, whether he understood what was going on in the proceedings, was at issue. The issue was him being frustrated and angry and saying he just wished to have a mental health evaluation. The nurse practitioner yesterday that commonly does the psych assessments found him to be lucid, to be calm, to be cooperative, to be understanding what was going on, and to be able to engage in conversations. I think there was even a part where, isn't it true, something, Mr. Davis, that she discussed with you whether or not you understood the charges? You stated that you did, and you understood the penalties if you were to be convicted, that there would be life sentences.
It was a guy. He was a good guy, nice guy. He hit on a lot of points, but a lot of points he missed from the last assessment I ever had. But he was basically spot on besides me saying being joyful. I wasn't
no, too, tearful.
I mean, yeah.
He did not say you were joyful. He said you were tearful.
Yeah, I teared up a couple times because of, I brought up my past to him and stuff like this. This is what, Your Honor, I have the utmost respect for you. You know why? Because if I had somebody like you in my life when I was that young little to fight, you fight for victims that can't fight for themselves. And I wanted to show you, but they didn't bring me my stuff. I wanted to show you all the things that I pay for a month. The St. Jude's, the Shade Tree, the police fund, the 9/11 police fund, the fire fund. I have literally, it's right in my property, like 10 agencies that I send money to. And one thing that's close to me is kids. And as a kid that was sexually abused and ran through the system, I read your bio. What you did, you're a champion. And I don't want to go to jail. I would want to help somebody like you. I would want to take advantage of my following and my financial resources to help, not to hurt.
So why don't we have Ms. Collins, do you have an offer already in mind that we can place on the record right now that him and Mr. Klaus could discuss?
I do, Your Honor. The state would offer him one count of soliciting a minor to engage in prostitution, one count of attempt lewdness with a minor under the age of 16. That would be fictitious because that law didn't exist at that time. It would be an underlying stipulated 4-10 with probation.
Okay. So, Mr. Klaus, would you mind please stepping into the side room and speaking with Mr. Davis about what that means? And then we can come out and discuss it on the record?
Your Honor, if I could have the district attorney send that to me in an email, please, just so I make sure that I get this correct. But as I understand it, essentially it's a stipulation for prison.
No, an underlying sentence.
So
it's a stipulation to probation with an underlying sentence of 4-10 years.
Yes, correct.
Still has to have a psychosexual evaluation. And I don't have your email to send that to you.
Your Honor?
Yeah.
With all due respect to those, I'd rather pay a $50,000 fine.
So I can't get...
I'd rather pay a huge fine and help. And I'd rather donate money to causes, every cause, and I'm willing and open to helping Ms. Collins in the future and for some things that I understand is going on.
Okay. So I can't... So the one thing about being a judge is I don't get to be involved in the negotiations at all. So if that's the offer, she has, in regards to negotiations, the district attorney has complete discretion. So that is the offer. If you'd like to talk about it with Mr. Klaus, you can. If that's not something you're interested in, that's fine. I can bring in the jury.
I'd like to talk to Mrs. Collins about it.
Ms. Collins.
Mrs. Collins.
Well, I will speak to him with Mr. Klaus. I just want to explain to you, sir, that in the state of Nevada, in Clark County, We don't settle criminal cases for financial contribution. That's not the way it works.
I'm not fine.
So, well, I know, but you wanted to pay a fine, and we don't, that's not how criminal works. That's how civil cases work. When it's you and one party fighting about, you know, property or something, then you settle for money. We don't do that in criminal cases. It involves a plea to a substantially reduced sentence, probation. I mean, I have a constituency that's a reasonable offer in my mind. So if you want to talk some more about it, if you want to,
we can talk some more about it. But your first offer was way better than that.
Well, that was my first offer after we've been in here fighting for a week. I brought victims in. I've talked to them. I've put them through hearings. I've done all those things. I've set aside other trials. I've set aside other victims.
Which witnesses
were you? My bad acts motion has been granted, so that is going to be.
So that's the offer, Mr. Klaus. Would you mind please speaking to Mr. Davis in regards to the offer? And in regard, I want to make sure in the negotiations for an attempt lewdness is you have to register as a sex offender, and you're also subject to lifetime supervision. Is that correct, Ms. Collins?
That is correct.
All right, so I want to make sure that you understand the full. So, Mr. Klaus, so it'd be those two counts. It'd be no opposition to probation. If Mr. Davis failed to stay out of trouble or didn't do well on probation, you'd go to prison for 4 to 10 years. And then the condition of that is he would be a registered sex offender and subject to lifetime supervision. So let's make sure all those are explained.
Yes, Your Honor, I can't do this. Like, if Your Honor, would. My line of work and my following, that registering as a sex offender would be just suicide. I'd be broken on the street.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's a great offer other than that. And like I said, I'm willing to help Ms. Collins in any way I can in the future. I have some things for her that she might be interested in. And I mean, I just think she's a good DA, and I just
so at this point, would you like to speak to Mr. Klaus, or are you rejecting that offer?
No, I'd like to speak to Mrs. Collins.
I know, but what you're saying is that you can't. I guess what you're saying to me is that you can't be a sex offender. Is that right?
Yes, I lose everything.
Ms. Collins, is there any offer that you would offer him where he would not be a sex offender?
With his history, I'm just hard pressed to do that.
So
that's that's my issue between Haywood, California. Right. You know those charges. We don't. Anyway, I just want to put on the record why that is the case. Between your 2004 case, between the young lady in 2011 and now the current case with two victims. So it's very difficult for me with my obligation to my community and my office to give you an offer that doesn't have sex offender registration. Now, those are about the lowest level sex felonies that I have to offer you. I mean, there's not anything less than that, really. That is for me to even say I agree to probation is a huge, huge extension of grace, in my opinion. So you may want to talk to Mr. Klaus about this.
Yes, Mrs. Collins?
Just so I'm clear, we're talking about a Category E felony, and then the other was a Category C, the attempt lewdness under 16?
Yes.
So it starts to be
attempt lewdness is a C?
Under 16.
Attempt lewdness was under 16.
Okay, Ms. Collins, with all due respect to that, I appreciate you wanting to commit, protect your community. But also with that, if you take this case, and then obviously we all heard the testimony of Ms. Munez, and then we heard the testimony from 2011, the acts that's said in this one is way extreme. So Mrs. Nunez said for herself that I never touched her, I never watched her bathe, I never did this. And the other girl said, basically, she gave me a blowjob. This one right here is saying, I touched her vagina, I touched her boobs, I, you know, forced her to give me a blowjob. It's not the same as the 2004 allegations, as the 2019 allegations are totally different.
Well, Mr. Davis, with all due respect, you have a history of inappropriately aged sex partners, and that's the way it is. The law looks at it much differently than you do. So I appreciate what you think the differential is. These are the lowest level sex felonies I have access to. I'm promising you probation. One is mandatory probation. That is what I'm willing to do. So if you want to discuss the upsides and downsides of that with Mr. Klaus, discuss what you think you should do. I mean, sex offender registration is not going to be off the table at this point. So
I think I should speak to you in private, and I can.
No, we can't do that.
I mean, and Marshall can do that, obviously, but I got information, Your Honor, on a sex trafficking ring in Vegas, and I'm willing to help you save some people's lives that really need to be helped. And I can't do it. I'm registered as a sex offender.
And I appreciate what you're saying, but Ms. Collins has given you the offer. Mr. Klaus, if you wouldn't mind taking him in there and explaining what the deal is. Okay.
I can't take him down anymore.
That's your right. No one can force you, but if you're saying you can't take it, that's fine. So the offer that was placed on the record, you're stating because you have to register as a sex offender, you're not willing to accept it. Is that right, sir?
Yes, it destroys me.
Okay. So the next point is I had asked the officers to put you in your clothes that you were wearing yesterday. The jury never saw anybody yesterday, and they told me that you refused.
No, it wasn't my clothes from yesterday.
What was it?
They wanted to put me in some clothes that they had. It wasn't my clothes. I asked them, could I have my clothes?
Oh.
And I was
a slack and a long sleeve shirt, Your Honor, collared shirt, tie.
Oh.
And they typically do.
Okay. So somewhere along the lines it got confused because I asked specifically said that he needed his personal clothes from yesterday.
Yes.
So is it your choice to be in the clothes that you have right now, or would you like your clothes that you were in yesterday before we proceed?
This is okay. I don't want to waste no more court time, Your Honor. No, this is fine. This is fine. But I do need my legal papers.
Well, that presents another problem.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So here's the thing. Your legal papers are in your personal property. Is that correct?
At one point, they couldn't find it in booking that all my papers was gone.
Okay. Don't worry.
Yesterday, Your Honor, I think we made a record that sees the case has custody of his legal papers.
Yeah, and we'll get them. Don't be worried about it. We'll get them.
Thank you.
But I just want to make sure, because you have a right not to be in what I refer to as blues, right? In jail clothes. But you're saying that that's what you want.
Yeah, Your Honor, I tried to get my clothes this morning.
Yeah, and I'll will get them for you. Would you like them?
No, Your Honor. I don't want to waste any more of the court
it's
time.
It's not about court time. You're not wasting my time. If you would like those clothes, we will go get them for you. I'm gonna have your legal papers brought over to you. Right now, though, I'm just gonna read them the instructions about the trial. And by the time I'm done with the instructions about the trial, your legal papers should be here.
Thank you, Your Honor.
You're welcome. See, Mr. Cios, is there someone over at the jail that can make sure his legal papers, which he would need for opening statements, are available, can be brought over to him?
In his property, or
it should be. The order was that everything that he left with, which was his legal papers. I think you have like a briefcase, right, Mr. Davis?
It's an accordion file with the snap over here.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you have an accordion file, and then did you have a bag?
Yeah, I had the backpack, and then I got the attorney file.
Yeah, and so then, I had asked that all of that be put into his property.
Yeah, and also the rest of my files that I forgot, they're in my trunk in my car across the street. It's like because you remember yesterday I was scrambling all over trying to find something? And I said, oh my God, I thought I lost it, but it's in my trunk. I'm pretty sure it's in my trunk of my car.
That was for the recusal hearing.
Right.
Yeah.
I couldn't find it, and I needed it.
Well, right, but the recusal hearing is over. So your legal papers that you were prepared with to go forward to tomorrow.
Right, it wasn't for the recusal. Those papers wasn't for the recusal hearing. It was for this trial that I'm missing.
Okay, well, I mean, I...
Because when I spread it all out on the table, I noticed, I said, it's missing.
Okay, well, your car, is your, has your car been moved?
No.
Your car's still in that same spot?
Yes, it's in the garage, parking garage right there.
Okay, and?
The keys in the front pocket of the backpack, Your Honor.
Okay, so why don't we get those? We'll get, those documents here. Let me do my introductory statements. I'll let Mrs. Collins do her opening arguments. Before we do your opening, we'll make sure we have all of your papers here. And then I have to do what's referred to as grand jury returns at 11 o'clock. That'll be a fine time to take a break. And then we'll make sure everything is here. Good?
Yeah, when we're done today, how do I get out of here? Because they usually take 24 hours to process you out. And
I'll make an order that you've been released.
Yeah, but if you make an order that I'm released, it's still going to take 24 hours to get me out of here and I'll miss court.
Well, court's not till Monday. It's Friday. All right, so I do believe that Mr. Davis's chains should be taken off, please.
Yes, ma'am. Do you mind if we have our sergeant come up here real quick so you can explain the whole property thing? Because when we go over there, they don't like us digging around in people's property. They can just come up missing the way. We can make this whole kind of waste claims made. So can he come up and can you kind of expedite the whole property thing?
Yeah.
Okay. Otherwise, it could take a while.
Got it. Yeah, let's get this thing moving. So if Mr. Davis's chains could be taken off, please?
Yes.
Okay. So he's going to be on house arrest, CCDC house arrest. Okay. I'm going to have that faxed over to jail right now.
Okay. So what we did, the clerk has been nice enough to expedite the paperwork. So you are released to house arrest, so to where we were when we started. And they're starting that paperwork right now, which hopefully will expedite that, okay?
Thank you. I appreciate it.
They also took his monitor, I guess, at the jail. He doesn't have his house arrest bracelet on now,
right.
So
that'll be, so he's released to house arrest, so they know that they'll have to reset it up.
So he'll have to go there after they work today on his own?
Actually, Your Honor, it takes 5 days for him to come and get you for house arrest.
For what?
It takes him 5 days to come and get you for house arrest.
Okay, well, we'll see. We'll talk to them today about what's going on.
The supervisor's coming up. He's on his way up, so when he gets up here, you can explain to him what you're requesting about his property.
Okay. How long will it take him
to? He's on his way down.
Okay.
He's right downstairs.
Oh, he's downstairs. Okay, great.
This will cut out too.
Mr. Davis, I do have a copy of that medical evaluation that I was talking about. Mr. Klaus, would you mind grabbing this, please? And then I'm marking this as an exhibit. Court's exhibit, please.
Yes, Mr. Davis, are we on the back card?
Yeah.
Everything has to be right.
That's okay.
Okay.
I would still like to help you out with some things.
You know, would you keep out of the front?
Okay. Just so you know, Mr. Davis, as an officer in the court and as a sworn deputy DA, I can't accept any assistance. If you have reports about that you want to give regarding any of the things you mentioned previously, that would have to be put in a police report to a detective or somebody advice.
Thank you. Also, Judge, Your Honor,
yes.
Is there any witnesses I can have or am I have a...
So what I need you to do is, maybe at a break today, if you can explain to me, I prefer you do it in writing, so maybe over lunch, in an affidavit explaining why there's a late notice. And then also, you do have to provide Ms. Collins with the last known address. I know everybody's here, so if you want to give her the cell phone numbers, because they do have the opportunity to reach out to them.
She has a cell phone number, two of them. Fred Wolf and Terry King. They put it on the emergency contact. Officer Kelly.
Okay, Officer Kelly has it, but Officer O'Kelly has it, but Ms. Collins doesn't. So put cell numbers on that list. And then, honestly, at the rate we're going, it might be 5 days before those people get called anyways, so. But yeah, so let's just provide that. Is the sergeant here? Hi, sir, how are you?
Good.
Would you mind coming up to a microphone can hear you?
Yes, ma'am.
And your name and P number, please?
Sergeant Coleman, 13843.
Thank you, Sergeant Coleman. So yesterday, we were about to begin trial and the defendant was remanded. And I had stated on the record that I wanted all of his legal papers to be placed into his personal property.
Okay.
Obviously, now we're starting the trial again, and so he needs all of his property.
Okay.
So what I asked the CEOs to do is to get everything from his personal property and bring it over, because we're about to start trial.
Okay. That would be a records situation. We don't have authorization to go onto his property and just grab his property. That will be a situation where we have to call a record supervisor, and then they will coordinate to get his property for him.
Okay.
I can make a phone call to the record supervisor and see what we can do in this matter. But as far as us doing that, we won't be able to do that, but I can make a phone call to record supervisors.
All right. Would you mind stepping back into my office and making that telephone call with my judicial executive assistant so that she can get on the phone with records and tell them that this needs to be done?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, thank you. Her name is Crystal. She's in my chambers.
You can go about it.
Either way. And my law clerk, Nicole, can help as well.
Thank you.
Judge, there's also the issue of the car keys, releasing them to the marshal.
Yeah.
Yes, and that's an entirely different process because we cannot authorize giving someone else his property. It's a legal thing. So he would have to sign some type of documents giving him permission.
Well, once everything's up here and it's in his care and custody and control, then he can have it again.
Well, he cannot have his property outside of the facility. This is not our facility.
So I released him. Does that make it?
Oh, is he released from
released.
Custody?
Yeah.
Okay, let me make a phone call.
Okay.
I'll be back.
While they're working all that out, can I bring the jury in and give them the instructions?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, let's get that done. All right?
Yes. Your Honor, can I have a break and go home and get new clothes?
No.
He has to be processed, right?
I'm only 10 minutes away and 10 minutes left.
Yeah, but I may have to put rise for the entrance of the jury.
All members of the jury, guys, and your honor.
Thank you. Any of the folks would approach briefly, please?